Mark loved the film. After you left Wolfman, were you worried about getting the project off the ground so quickly? Because it seemed to come together quite quickly for you.
You know, that was a traumatic thing to have to leave a film after that amount of work. And you do kind of panic and worry that, you know, did I just blackball myself because I walked off a big movie? But I got it. The first call I got was from the head of, at the time, the head of Fox Searchlight, Peter Rice, who I made 1 hour photo with. And he called me with this extremely supportive phone call saying, you made the right choice from what I hear, and don't worry about it. I would hire you in a second, and you're going to work again. And it was a very nice phone call. And then about 2 or 3 weeks later, he called me up, and he said, are you still interested in that Never Let Me Go? Because I guess there was another director involved initially, and he fell off that project, off this project. And I said, yeah, I am.
But this was serendipitous, because you were already a fan of the novel, I believe.
Oh, yeah. A fan of all of his novels, but particularly this one, yeah.
So I guess you felt a personal connection with the material already. It was there.
Yeah, I mean, I read the book the week it came out and was moved to tears by it and couldn't stop thinking about it, which is a dynamic that a lot of people experience with this book. It sort of haunts you. You can't shake it, really. And I read, so I went back and read it again. And it was on the second reading that I kind of started to feel this could really be a very beautiful and odd film.
It's such a particularly British tale. The emotions and the way people deal with emotions and the repression that goes on is a very British thing. As an American, were you worried about that at all? Bringing your sensibility to that, or?
Well, I mean, the themes I think are universal. Perhaps it has an English quality in the kind of understatement and the reserve of it. There's also, I think, a thread of a Japanese sensibility in it too, because Kazuo was raised in Japan until he was six. I mean, I've spent a lot of time in England, and I have an affinity for English things and a bit of an Anglophile. I had a lot of help also, I mean, with the English crew. But, you know, I took some strength from the idea that, and, you know, an outsider can sometimes have a clearer perspective on things. And I kept thinking about how Ang Lee's The Ice Storm, which is my adolescence, really, in suburban America, was so authentic to me, and this was made by a Taiwanese director. So I think it's more, it's the connection to the material, an understanding of the material.
Absolutely. I love the timelessness of the world that you constructed. Even though it takes place in three different time periods, it still feels essentially almost like it's ripped from the 50s in a strange way. Was that, again, I guess, something that you wanted to bring to it?
I guess I wanted to be really accurate about how periods really look, you know, and I think that most films, if you make it in the 70s, everybody's wearing the latest fashions and it's very 70s clothes and 70s hairstyles, and that's just not how the world really works. I mean, I couldn't really necessarily guess that it's 2010 from what you're wearing, because you're wearing fairly classic clothes. In a way, probably so am I. The quality that you're describing, it was perhaps just came from trying to be authentic.
I can't let you go without talking about the fantastic cast, principally, of course, Kira, Carrie, and Andrew. Where did they come from for you? Were you aware, obviously, of Kira beforehand, but Andrew and Carrie, were they unknown quantities for you?
No, I was aware of Carrie because, you know, I had seen her work, and we were having trouble casting Kathy, and the head of the studio at the time, again, Peter Rice, he saw the world premiere of An Education at Sundance, and he texted us and said a four-word text that said, hire the genius Mulligan. We were struggling to find Kathy.
Yeah.
So we flew to New York and met Carrie. The only reason we didn't audition her is because she was in a play in New York and we were in England. And we didn't think we could get the movie financed with her at the time because she was somewhat unknown. And Kira came on board because she actually contacted us. She reached out to us because when they heard that we had cast Carrie in the lead, Kira's agent contacted us and said, have you cast the part of Ruth? Because Kira's very keen to work with Carrie. As far as Andrew's concerned, I had seen him in Boy A, which is a spectacular English film that I recommend all your readers and viewers see. And I think he's as astonishing in that film as Carrie is in An Education.
Looking at Andrew's performance, did you get any sense that he was a future Spider-Man, for example?
I got the sense that he could do anything he wanted, that he would bring an authenticity and a sensitivity and a detail and a commitment to any kind of role. So I didn't necessarily think he was going to jump into a mainstream film. And I do wonder how mainstream it's going to be. I think with Mark Webb and the way I'm hearing it's being cast, and it sounds like it's a fairly eccentric version of a comic book movie. But I think he could do anything.